And now the end is near, and so I face the final curtain. My friend, I'll say it clear, I'll state my case, of which I'm certain.
Hi you guys, happy Friday. Yes, 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 I said Friday. And as promised, I'm going to talk to you today about organized crime, aka the Mafia, aka Cosa Nostra, aka the mob. But we're going to focus primarily on the American mob, which started with Italians and Sicilians. Before we do that, however, I want to give you some etymology. That's word origins, okay? The word mafia is derived from an adjective in Sicilian, the Sicilian language, that is mafioso, okay? And that means bravado, that means bravery, that means swagger, okay? In Italian, they say mafioso, but it means the same thing. If they're talking about a woman, however, in Italian, and they call her mafiosa, that means she's beautiful or she's very attractive. Every single group that is considered a mafia group has different enterprises like criminal and different activities that they're responsible for. But they are all, in order to be considered mafia, they all engage in protection racketeering. And I want to show you a clip, a movie clip, with an example of protection racketeering. And it's not a mafia movie. You might be surprised what movie it is, but here it is.
Hey, give me 50 cents so I can buy a pop.
I don't have any, Rand.
Come on, I'll pay you back.
I don't have...
Stop. Don't. Stop. Stop.
Don't.
Oh, here, here.
How's your neck?
Stings.
That's too bad. Pedro offers you his protection.
Hey, let me borrow your bike.
No.
Come on, I'll give you some chips.
No.
So that's Napoleon Dynamite, the movie. And the little kinky-haired guy that was taking a drink at the water fountain, that's Napoleon Dynamite, who is best, who really his only friend, besides Deb, is a Hispanic male named Pedro Sanchez, who's new to the school, okay? And they're all, you know, kind of outcasts or whatever. Well, the little nerd boy there that's getting beat up, he, you know, Napoleon sees it and he feels sorry for him because, you know, Napoleon's been beat up all his life too. And so what you see him doing is going over there and handing that kid, Napoleon handing that kid a boondoggle keychain and saying, Pedro offers you his protection, because Pedro is running for the president of the student body. Okay. So the next part of that is when the kid is leaving school for the day, we're assuming, and he's taking his bike, trying to take his bike out of the rack, and the bully comes back and tries to grab his bike. But then these big muscle guys come up in this hydraulically lifted car, beep, 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 and they look at the guy, the bully, and they're like, don't do it. But they don't even have to say anything. They're just like, and the bully runs off. And so the kid, the nerd kid, is protected. That is protection racketeering. Basically, without saying it, Napoleon was saying, if you vote for Pedro and give him your loyalty over Sama, that was who was running against him, then he will protect you from this bully. And then all of a sudden, you know, the henchmen come up. Yeah. That is protection racketeering. So in order to qualify as mafia, a mafia group, that has to be involved in there. Why am I showing you a New Orleans sign? I'm glad you asked. Because in the 1800s, because of its location on, as a port city, there were a lot of Italian immigrants coming up that way that stopped there and settled there. And there was a lot of crime in New Orleans at that time because it was a port city. There was transient people. So groups of these Italian people became mafia groups because they protected other people there and kind of formed their own little, you know, communities and protection and rules and all that stuff and had their own little enterprises going on. Okay. At about the same time in New York City, the Sicilians were immigrating to New York City. And largely, that population was largely the ones that were immigrating there. And they did the same thing. And there were basically five different families that got wealthy from these enterprises and things. And they became known as the Five Points Gang. Five different families, and now they are the five families of the American Mafia. So it didn't all start in New York. There was mafia down south, too. It's a true story. You've probably heard of this guy, even if you don't recognize him. Take a look. So if you've heard of him, you've heard of him as probably Lucky Luciano, okay? His real name was Charles Luciano, Chucky Lucky, Lucky Chucky. And historians still argue about how he got the nickname Lucky. There's a story that he was playing, you know, rolling dice, illegal dice, throwing dice there, and he won $244 in the pot. And he quit his job, and he started a protection racketeering group for Jewish youth. Okay. There's another story, and this is one is a little more plausible to me, that in a 20-year time period, he was arrested 25 times and never spent a night in jail. That is pretty lucky. And then there's another story that he actually had his throat slit and lived to tell about it, which was the truth. And that is definitely lucky. His luck ran out, however, when he was busted for a prostitution enterprise. But before that, he actually is the one who united the five families because he was one of the, you know, you work your way up in the mafia, but he had hit the big time. He was the top guy there. And the Italian and Sicilian term for that is, capo de tutti capi. So capo di tutti capi, and that translates to bosses of all bosses. You and I know it better as Godfather. So Luciano was a Godfather. There were four other ones, and they all got together and formed a commission. In Godfather 3, when they're in that hotel and the hit comes and the helicopter comes and starts blowing them all up, that is the commission. And what the commission does is it governs all these little groups, these mafia groups. So they're not on each other's turf, so they're not killing each other, so they can all make money off the criminal enterprises without stepping on each other's toes. And Lucky Luciano is the one who got that going. He said, we got to get organized. And so before he got busted for the prostitution ring, he did that. When he got busted for the prostitution ring, they gave him 50 years in prison. And he would have died in you know, prison. However, when World War II rolled around, he was so well-versed on Italian and Sicilian life that the federal government used him to make deals there in Sicily to be basically to, you know, come over to the Allied side, basically. And so, because of his service getting those things set up and because of his service during World War II, his sentence was commuted. So he was allowed to get out of prison before 50 years. But one of the conditions was that he had to be immediately deported to Italy. But he gets out of prison, he's deported, and he goes back to Italy and dies. He was a patriot, though. He was a patriot. Let's talk about Goodfellas. Goodfellas is arguably Martin Scorsese's best movie of all time. The best movie he's done. And I'm not the only one who feels this way. It is a delight to watch. It is very authentic. Martin Scorsese let the actors, and there's a lot of great actors in that movie, Joe Pesci, Robert De Niro, Ray Liotta, he let them improv a lot in that movie. In fact, maybe too much, because there was over 300 uses of the word that starts with F and ends with K. And I'm not talking about Frank. The four-letter word. That word was used 300 times in the movie, and over one-third of those times was by Joe Pesci himself during his improvisation. But it did turn out to be very authentic because a little-known fact is Ray Liotta's mother died of cancer, breast cancer, during the filming of that movie, and he used the rage and sadness that he felt from her death in a lot of his scenes, and it came out very, very real because it was real. And the scene where he beats the shit crap out of, his girlfriend, the guy that's messing with his girlfriend, Karen, during one of the takes, he hit that guy so hard that, the guy, was injured. Yeah. The part where, they kill Billy Bats, Joe Pesci and Robert De Niro kill Billy Bats in the bar, and Robert De Niro's like stomping him, you know, like kicking him. The guy who played Billy Bats in that movie wore protective clothing and all this like armor underneath his, clothes so that he wouldn't get, you know, hurt as badly. But De Niro was so into it. He kicked him so many times and so hard, that the padding failed and the guy the next day woke up with bruises all over him. So if it looks real, it's because it was. And what's really real about Goodfellas is how those guys were blue collar guys. They weren't in the gilded mansions that the Corleones were. That was a different time period. This is very authentic as far as how they get in the mafia. They live in these families that are close together and Henry Hill watched the mafia from the time he was a boy and then became an errand boy for them and then became, you know, a good fella for them. So it's very, very authentic. Henry Hill, of course, was a real person and he ended up, flipping, and becoming a rat, which part of, mafia organizations is something called omerta. And omerta says the worst thing you could ever do is betray your family. The worst thing you could ever do is be a rat. And the only punishment, the punishment for being a rat is death. You got to be murdered. They got to kill you. Omerta also says that there are certain crimes that do not need to be committed because it's not practical to bring that much heat on the organization. They want to stay out of that spotlight so that they don't have to worry about the prosecution and all that. So bringing that kind of attention, and that would be like kidnapping or, you know, killing a government official, something like that. So Omerta is kind of their guide, their guiding principles, if you will. And Henry Hill broke every single one of those. And it's all because of what happened in 1970. So in 1970, RICO was enacted, and that is the racketeering involved Corrupt Organization Act of 1970. And basically it changed everything as far as the way the federal government looked at organized crime. So instead of going after little bitty, you know, henchmen for things or just going after them for crimes, the federal government passed RICO that said they were kind of trapped into that situation because they, you know, they, there's always somebody above them. So the federal government said, in RICO, we can now stop prosecuting the head guys and take down the head. The capo di tutti capi. That's who we want. Like, you can't kill a snake without cutting its head off. All right. So that's what RICO did. And it enforced, it, you know, it put a lot of pressure on these mob bosses and, on the low, I mean, from, it was a trickle down thing. Henry Hill, knew he was going down, and he knew he had to do something about it. So in 1970, when the RICO Act was, in effect, was enacted, so was WITSEC, which is witness protection, okay, witness security. And so, because they knew, the feds knew they were going to need inside people, and the only way to make someone flip because of America was to offer them protection. So they offered protection to anybody who would give them information, and then they would let them have a new identity. And Henry Hill knew it was coming. He knew he had done too much, and he went into witness protection. The thing is, he sold out his people, you know, and he always feared he had a hit on him. And he probably would have been killed by the mafia had it not been disorganized and running scared at the time, that, you know, he was kicked out of witness protection because he went back to his same old ways. And the feds were like, no more, we're not helping you no more because, you know, you're going and still doing your drugs. You're still seeing your guma, that's girlfriend, you know, not his wife, all this stuff. Henry Hill was a bad guy. He got kicked out of federal protection, but he ended up dying of natural causes. He actually played a role. He played a small bit part in Goodfellas, as did Martin Scorsese's mother. She plays Joe Pesci's mother in the movie, and his father. His father is one of the inmates in there with Henry when Henry is in prison. And he's the one that Henry says put too many onions in the gravy, or too many onions in the spaghetti sauce. So it was kind of a family affair there. Henry Hill was in that movie. And for that movie, he made $500,000. And Henry Hill said, that's chump change. This is chump change. Hollywood, you get all of our stories and then you don't give it back. That's chump change. When I was in my heyday, I was clearing $15,000 to $45,000 per week. Don't tell me crime don't pay. Crime pays. So Henry Hill was quite the little rat there, little dirty rat is what he was. But he, you know, RICO hurt the mafia. WITSEC probably saved his life. Balance. What are you gonna do? You guys, I will see you tomorrow and Sunday. And then Angelina will be back next week. And go watch Goodfellas. Go watch Donnie Brasco. Go watch the Godfather movies. They're all good. But the most authentic, I think, to be honest, are based on the true stories of actual people that were involved in the mafia in one way or the other. So go watch them and have a great weekend. I'll see you guys maybe tomorrow, Sunday. Bye.